Shall I introduce you in the meantime? Although I don't think he needs an introduction anymore. He was the man who 10 years ago made the cartoon that enraged a lot of places in the world. Can I have a big applause again for Kurt Westergaard? Okay, Mr. Westergaard, are you ready?
I'm ready.
Yeah? Do we have the microphone? Yes? Wait, I'll just... You're okay like that? Okay. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much for your kind invitation. I'm very happy to be here. And I will say something about my little business, the cartooning, and then perhaps a little about tolerance and freedom, and tell you something about how I have experienced this period. What is it like, the profession that I and other cartoons share? Are we but mere clowns who visually entertain or even amuse the readers on their travels across the endless plains of words on the newspaper page? Or are we sensitive seismographs detecting the tremors of coming political earthquakes and the catastrophes that follow in their wake? Are we sometimes throwing cartoon roadside bombs, not to derail, but to warn and bring politics back on the right track? Satire is loved, but also hated. There is a little anecdote about the American president, Jimmy Carter, who met with former Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev. The conversation turned to the satirical cartoons in newspapers. Carter said, I like them, I collect them, I actually believe I can learn something from them. I have two bookcases filled with cartoons. Brezhnev answered, I am also a collector of cartoonists. I actually have two full camps in Siberia. I think cartoonists could learn something by that. I believe that some of the mighty ones on Earth fear the political cartoon more, perhaps, than they fear mountains of analytical articles, because the drawing has an appeal that no analysis has. But satire doesn't come out of the blue, but in response to a provocation. There is an old anecdote about the Spanish painter Pablo Picasso, who painted the famous Guernica painting during the Spanish Civil War in 1937, after German Nazi warplanes had bombed the small town of Guernica. During the German occupation of France, Picasso met a German Air Force officer who asked him, "Did you do Guernica?" "No," said Picasso, "you did." A little anecdote which in fact is also the satirist's working formula. Then of course we have the question of religion. Should religion supersede democracy and require special treatment? The Danish answer is no. As an old, friendly, and as far as religion goes, tolerant atheist who respects everybody's faith and their right to have their faith, The intolerance of one religion in particular has surprised me and my countrymen. As an atheist, I would like to remind you about the old anecdote from Northern Ireland. A man is walking on the street down the road and is stopped by a roadblock. The man behind the roadblock asks him, "Are you Catholic or are you Protestant?" The man answers, "I'm an atheist." The man behind the block goes on, "Are you a Catholic atheist or Protestant atheist?" But if you are going to illustrate an article, for example, about Christianity and capitalism, how to avoid drawing Jesus Christ dressed like a businessman in a smart Armani suit, leaving the cross. On the cross, the empty cross, there is now a poster. "See you 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. or 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. And if you are going to illustrate a pro-Palestinian letter from the readers, how to avoid drawing a Middle East man wearing a yellow star. Instead of the usual inscription, Jude, you can read the inscription, Arab. Both Jews and Christians were furious. But I could talk with them over the telephone, receive their threats, but it was not threats on my life, of course. With my drawing, I wanted to show that a religion, which I respect, it has extremists who use or abuse part of the Holy Scripture as spiritual ammunition and explosives for murder and destruction. The drawing was justified, and now they want to kill me. But I have every intention of surviving, living an almost normal life in collaboration with PET, the Danish Intelligence and Security Service. The PET people are very professional when it comes to safety, but they also have remarkable human qualities. They are always very understanding and totally committed. They follow me wherever I go, so we get to know each other quite well. And there are two things that they are happy that I am not. This is our internal joke. They are happy unlike many Scandinavians, I take no pleasure in winter bathing. And they are also very happy that I am not a nudist. I am proud to live in a small, very tolerant country, a country that may have lost her international innocence after the so-called Mohammed crisis, but a country where every single politician supports the freedom of speech. An old German writer once said, "Humor ist, wenn man trotzdem lacht." Humor is when you laugh in spite of everything. And that's what I try to live by. A certain kind of self-censorship is revealing among my equals, the creative intellectuals. This self-censorship, one of the Inquisition's distant relatives, is neither bureaucratic nor visible, but the fragile eggheads among my equals will not be able to cope with self-censorship, and eventually the shells will start to crack. It's legal to be afraid, but my own basic feeling has been anger. Anger at having been threatened. And anger is a good active feeling when you are threatened. Denmark has received a lot of Muslims and welcomed them and given them everything that the Danish welfare state has to offer, from money to accommodation and free education. The only thing we ask in return is that they respect our democratic traditions. So when we satirize Muslim fellow countrymen, this is not an act of exclusion, but this is rather an act of inclusion in Danish society, consistent with the way we satirize Danes in general. This so-called Muhammad crisis was not the first caricature crisis in Denmark. In January 1933, Adolf Hitler has been given the power over Germany by Marshal Hindenburg. In October the same year, Hans Bendix, a Danish cartoonist of semi-Jewish descent, published a magazine which, in text and drawings, revealed the coming horrors of Nazism. Mr. Bendix was summoned to appear before the Prime Minister, who said threateningly, "We cannot leave foreign policy in the hands of a cartoonist. The Germans are furious. Think about our exports." So the Prime Minister threatened the cartoonist with dismissal from the Social Democratic newspaper that he worked for unless he closed Onnehul, translated, I think it meant something like the breathing hole. The cartoonist's later drawings were unanimously condemned during a heated debate in the Danish parliament. It says in the preface of the magazine that its publication should be ill-timed, and ill-timed indeed it was. So today we can put the question, how far have we come as for the freedom of speech? Is it unconditional or not? What about tolerance? Tolerance and freedom, are they two sides of the same coin? We all have an urge to be free, even though we are willing to dispense from this freedom in certain situations. Tolerance, on the other hand, is not an innate trait of man in many ways. It goes against our nature. Tolerance is something we have to learn because it goes against the grain to have to live with what we condemn and dislike. In the light of this, editors and journalists are faced with an important task of challenging their readers' tolerance in an effort to combat the many echo chambers of our time. The debate about freedom, which we have witnessed during the last decade, shows quite clearly that many people see freedom and tolerance as oppositions. This means that people may be labeled as intolerant if they defend their freedom, whereas they may be criticized for trying to undermine freedom when they claim to be tolerant. As far as I can tell, this tension field between freedom and tolerance is due to the concept of tolerance having lost its original meaning. It has undergone dramatic change and becomes a threat to freedom, not least because it has contributed to breaking down the difference between words and action, which is fundamental to any democracy. In a liberal country, tolerance and freedom have to be closely connected. The stronger the tension field is between freedom of speech and tolerance, the bigger the risk of eroding society's democratic foundation. When a society becomes less tolerant, it becomes less free, and when freedom is restricted, it is because society has become less tolerant. In Denmark, we allow all political parties. We also allow parties, among them Nazi parties, Hizb ut-Tahrir, because we want to have our strong opponents out in the open. That's a very good thing, I think. Now at last, I would like to read a poem for you. It's a poem written by a Norwegian friend. His name is Geir Lystrup. He is a writer and a composer. And I think that this poem may perhaps be considered as blasphemy, but for me it's more a wish dream which hasn't come true and which perhaps never will come true. But we can hope. The title is Lady Star to Mother God. Mother God sat alone in her empty heavenly space. Slowly she began to draw the moon, sun, stars, which in myriads danced out of her hand. A fantastic universe which stardust has traversed. Bright and great, but all too still, Mother God took out her loop, focused on a star, painted it with mountain and water, fish and great whales, painted she, and a giraffe, plants, animals, and in a trice, a monkey, and you and me. It was also so good on Our Lady Star with play and sweet music. But into the paradise soon came religion and politics. Worse still, many gods appeared in the east and west, gods of the true faith, for holy war and the sea of gore. Oh, no, 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 said Mother God, you Lady Star, do not fare well. Allah, Yahweh, and Lord Jesus, all of gods, great and small, lay down your cross and weapons here. I shall assembly an ecumenical conference. Now there must be another dance. So now all the gods sit up there in debate, which make our small globe seem quite godforsaken. But we can just hope, and I don't think Mother God will let her sons down until they have promised to give us peace. Thank you very much.
Mr. Vestergaard, thank you. I wanted to ask just something practical. Would you like to sit here, or would you like to move okay, let's do that. Maybe we can change this a little bit here. And your glass of water. There you go. Oh, are you okay?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Mr. Westergaard, thank you for your words tonight. We'll have some other guests in a moment on stage to talk with you about what you said. And before we do that, I would like to ask you some questions, and I want to go back in time with you. Oh, everything okay here? Okay. I want to go back 10 years ago. You were in your house, an empty piece of paper, pencil in your hand. What went into your mind? What was going on? What did you want to express?
Yes, I have worked during my many years at the newspapers, lots of so-called editorial cartoons, and this was, as the English say, just another day at the office. But it wasn't just another day at the office. I could see that afterwards. But it was, I made this drawing which was aimed at the terrorists who are abusing a great religion and using parts of this religion as their spiritual and as their spiritual ammunition and explosives. And yes, that was what I did. And then there were 12 colleagues who also made a comment in form of a cartoon to this paper.
So it was for you just another day at the office?
It was just another day job, yes.
And now we're sitting here in this fortress, and this is only just one hour for us, but for you it's your whole life, because then you went on a holiday to Florida, as I understood, and you're seeing on television burning embassies in Tehran, in Damascus, in Beirut. Could you make the connection?
Well, I was really scared. It was terrible to see. I understand it like that there are regimes in the Middle East, perhaps, which has problems to fulfill their population's needs, and then the frustration they raise, and then the regime can let some of the frustrations loose, converting frustration into aggression. And then we had these riots. And I don't think they could have occurred without the permission of the regimes. And yes, it was terrible, because for my part, and I also think for my colleagues' part, we wanted to go after not Islam as a whole, but after some features which we didn't like.
And what features were the fanatic side of?
Yeah, it was, first of all, it was terrorism. It has, but we were very surprised that there may be so strong forces in a religion. And we were very surprised.
But
my basic feeling was anger. I have only done my job, and I have made a comment on a very serious thing, namely terrorism.
Terrorism, that was your purpose too.
And it has nothing to do with the drawing was not aimed at the normal law-abiding, democratic-minded Muslim, not at all. It was only the terrorists we want.
That was your purpose. And then you were in Florida, you saw things happening, hardly conceivable, and now, 10 years later, your life has completely changed.
Yeah.
Can you go out shopping,
now,
for example?
You see, I'm an old man, so I would like to understand what really drives a young man to become a radicalist, become an Islamist, and wanting to kill me. So I have applied for a conversation with this young man who tried to kill me during the Danish Council of Reconciliation.
And this was a few years ago when you were attacked in your own house with an axe.
Yes, I don't hate this young man. I am sorry for him. And I would like to talk with him about quite ordinary things. How are your life now? What do you expect from the future? I want to show him a normal human interest in his fate.
So you...
That is, for my side, it would be a kind of a reconciliation.
And is there a chance that a conversation
I
that
will
take
know
place?
It.
Yes, you have a request. We have a request now.
No, I haven't got an answer now.
Not an answer yet. No. So, but you did think about how does a guy like that think?
Yeah.
And did you find out anything apart from the conversation you might have?
I don't know. I haven't had the conversation.
But going into the mind of your attacker, did it give you something?
Yeah, perhaps it would give me explanation.
Because
I am not meeting this man to condemn him. I'm trying to understand him. When you are 80, you are not hostile anymore. That is waste of time.
It's a waste of time.
More exciting to try to understand people.
Yeah.
Why do they do as they do?
And this is something you still.
So this young man is perhaps he is also a victim. I think he a victim of political conditions in another world, if I may say so, on which we don't have much influence.
You said something in your speech. You made the dilemma: are we just cartoonists? Just shortly said, or are we sensitive seismographs?
Yeah.
How do you see yourself?
Well, as I think, I see myself as a mixture, perhaps. As I also mentioned that I have, as a cartoonist, insulted other people, other religions. But in Denmark, it's tradition that all those in power, they may be attacked or exposed by cartoon satire.
So you
and now we treat our Muslim fellow citizens the same way as we treat normal Danes. That is, for my part, a kind of inclusion.
You say it's an inclusion, it's not an exclusion.
No, it's the opposite.
It's the opposite.
Yeah.
I saw an interview with you, with our colleagues of Nieuwsuur, a Dutch news program, and you said it was just after the attacks I think Denmark, and you said, I'm worried about integration.
Yes.
What did you mean by that?
Well, I think what happened in Copenhagen, also in Paris, we had an attack in Copenhagen, of course it damages, and I'm sorry for that, it damages integration, absolutely, and it creates generalization.
Of Muslims, you mean?
Yeah. But the more active the Muslims in Denmark are in the democratic processes, the more they will be integrated.
So you still think things will be all right in the end?
Yes.
Or is that too simply said?
I don't think Mother God can do more. It's up to us, the ethnic Danes and the Muslim fellow men.
I want to ask you another question, and then I'll ask the guests to come on stage. If today Jyllandsposten, the paper you worked for, you made the cartoon for, would ask you that same assignment, would you make this drawing, and you were back on your table with your white, clean paper sheet, pencil in your hand, would you do the exact same thing?
Those cartoons will not be repeated.
You don't think that the request will be there at all?
No,
But if the request will be there,
I understand the question. But you know, I cannot perhaps give you any answer. It has happened,
mm-hmm.
And you. I have worked according to my country's traditions. I have done nothing wrong. So. In a way, I feel that it is a quite wrong and absurd situation that I am in, that I must be protected to live in my own country.
Mm-hmm.
But as I said, I got very angry, and anger is a good active feeling when you are, when somebody is after you.
Okay, Mr. Østergaard, please stay here because I want to bring on stage the next guests we have. I'd like to ask them, they're all dealing with freedom of speech issues. Need to think about this every day. Do I print it, publish it, yes or no? Can I have an applause for Shirin Moussa? She's founder of Femme for Freedom. Brahim Boursik. He's editor-in-chief of the Moslimkrant and editor-in-chief of NRC Next, Hans Nijenhuis. And I would like to start with Brahim Boursik. You're the chief editor-in-chief of the Moslimkrant, and now you're working on a glossy about Mohammed.
Yes.
For the people that don't know, what will be in your glossy?
Well, we're trying to give another side of the Prophet Muhammad than what the people and the journalists are doing in Holland. Because we want to teach also the children, our children, because I have also two. And we are talking with the children, they know nothing about the Prophet Muhammad, only that they know is they must do with the Ramadan, that they can drink alcohol and that they don't have to have sex, you know, before the marriage. And that's a pity, because I think there are a lot of things that we can do and must know about our Prophet Muhammad. And that's what we're going to try to do in the Muhammad Glossy.
And when you listen to Mr. Vestergaard's story, his explanation of the cartoon, what would you say about it? Is it, by the way, a cartoon that could be in the glossy?
I can't give you an answer on that, because if I do, then we don't have any glossy anymore at the time that we're... No, I have respect for Mr. Westgaard, and it's a shame that a man who is 80 years old now must have so much things that he make now in all the security things that we make. I think, as a Muslim, it is un-Islamic. And I mean it. I don't like his cartoons. And that doesn't mean that I can give him the freedom to do his work if he wants. But I don't like it. So what?
Mr. Westergaard?
Yes, but thank you very much for your positive reaction. In a way, I interpreted it. I'm very glad to hear you saying the things you said. Very glad. But it may have been terrorism of perhaps of another background. And I think my reaction would have been the same. What I have tried to explain Muslim fellow citizens, I haven't been able to talk with very many, they haven't wanted to talk with me, is that this has nothing to do with you as ordinary, democratic-minded Danish Muslims. It has to do with the abuse of your God. Mm. You know, the idea, if I may tell that, came from a play from an old romantic poet in Denmark, Oehlenschläger. He wrote a play called Aladdin. And in this play, there is a saying, to get an orange in your turban, that means luck. And then I thought, well, to get a bomb in your turban, that means the opposite. That was some of the idea's background. But I have always underlined that this cartoon is made against the terrorists and not against Muslims
and your religion as a whole. But it has been very difficult, if not impossible, to get a dialogue on this matter. I'm very sorry. I have tried. So I'm happy to hear you.
Brian?
Well, as I said, ik ga het in het Nederlands doen. Ik denk dat je echt gewoon in taal moet spreken die het gewoon het beste hebt. I'm sorry, but I'm going to talk Dutch, because otherwise I can't express myself.
I'll try to translate.
Yes, try it better, please. Ik vind het echt werkelijk gewoon schandalig dat een man van 80 jaar op deze manier nog zijn laatste dagen in zijn leven, al weten we natuurlijk niet wie de eerste weggaat in deze aarde verlaat, maar ik vind het echt verschrikkelijk.
Yuri is going to translate.
Yes, okay.
Outrageous that a man of your age, who might be soon leaving this world, has to.
No, I don't say that. I don't say that.
Yuri.
No. Don't put words on my mouth.
I'm sorry.
No.
I'm trying to translate it.
We're trying to get a dialogue here.
Repeat it. I'm trying to translate it. Okay. I think it's outrageous that a man of your age needs to fear for his life. That's
okay.
No?
Goed.
Please continue.
Aan de andere kant, ik vind wel dat er heel veel moed aanwezig is bij de man op zijn leeftijd. Ik bedoel, ik zie de man en ik zie echt mijn opa van 80 jaar.
And I see a lot of courage in this man. I see a man of 80 years old and I see my own grandfather in you.
Die voor zijn leven moet nu vrezen omdat hij gewoon een tekening heeft gemaakt.
Who has to fear for his life just because he drew a drawing.
En ik vind het jammer. Vooral ik denk werkelijk, even terug naar je vraag ook Peter, begin over de Mohammed Glossy. Wij studeren ons nu helemaal suf, werkelijk suf, om te kijken wat in die Mohammed Glossy moet komen. Wat kan wel, wat kan niet.
And I think it's a pity, and we really, really try to study very hard what we can put in our glossy about Mohammed. What we can and what we can't.
En ik lees heel veel. En ik kom echt heel veel dingen tegen. En ik weet zeker dat als de profeten in de voorbeelden spreken voor zich.
And I read a lot and I'm sure that if the prophet speaks about examples.
Toen de profeet, vrede zij met hem, nog leefde, heeft hij verschrikkelijke dingen meegemaakt. En hij heeft altijd tegen de mensen nooit gezegd van ik ga jullie doodmaken. Ik zal een kort voorbeeldje geven.
And the prophet lived through terrible times and never said I will kill you. I will give you an example of that.
Er komt een man in de moskee. In de moskee, de heiligste plek voor een moslim.
A man is coming into the mosque, the most holy place for a Muslim there is.
En wat doet de man? Die gaat in een hoek in de Arabische wereld, midden in de woestijn, er is maar vier muurtjes, die gaat in een hoek zitten plassen.
And the man is going to loiter somewhere in the corner.
He's
peeing in the corner.
What was that word?
Sorry, it's a British word.
Oh, sorry.
Ik vind het wel...
Excuse my British, yes.
Ik vind het wel leuk dat we lachen. Want ik had al zo'n gevoel van, nou, moet niet gelachen worden. Maar ik ben blij dat we in ieder geval...
En wel gelachen worden.
Een van de metgezellen van de profeet, Arabieren, woestijn. Ik zeg altijd, woestijn maakt je hard.
One of the companions of the prophet, an Arab, a man from the desert.
En de regen maakt je zacht.
The desert,
zijn
makes,
denk ik ook
the
zacht.
Desert makes you tough, and the rain will make you soft.
Dus de man die pakt zijn zwaard, die loopt naar de man die in de hoek en die wil zijn kop van zijn lichaam afhakken. De profeet zegt, wat ben je aan het doen?
The man takes his sword, wants to decapitate the peeing man in the corner, and the prophet says, hey, what the are you doing?
De man zegt, hij plast in onze moskee.
The man says he's peeing in our corner of the mosque.
De profeet zegt, rustig, ga zitten, niet tegen jouw hands, dus je moet niet persoonlijk opnemen.
And the prophet says, you know, sit down.
De profeet loopt naar de man, hij zegt, broer, wat ben je aan het doen? Hij zegt, ja, profeet, ik moet plassen, ik kan nergens plassen buiten, dus er is een hoekje hier, kom hier plassen. Mm-hmm. De profeet zegt, pak een emmer water, gooit op die het spul en de zaak was opgelost.
Okay, so the prophet goes to the man and says, what are you doing here? I'm peeing, and the man says, well, yeah, and the prophet says, you know, take a bucket of water, you know, wash it away, and that's it.
Mr. Westergaard, did you understand the anecdote?
Ja, precies.
I do hope so, because we don't want to do it again. But what is the moral of the story?
De moreel van het verhaal is, ik vind dat hij moet kunnen tekenen wat hij wil. En het is niet aan ons om hem of wat dan ook het leven onmogelijk te maken.
So I think that Mr. Westergaard should be allowed to draw whatever he wants to draw, and it's not for us to judge him on his drawings.
Het is tussen hem en zijn schepper.
It's between him and his God.
En daarmee sluit ik dus ook mijn verhaal.
And that's what I want to say.
Ik vind wel, I think what it's interesting, you were saying, I'm working on this glossy about Mohammed. I have to make a lot of decisions. What is allowed, what is not allowed. And I'm breaking my head over it. Can you give us an example over which you were really in doubt, what shall I do? Is this going to be in the glossy or not?
Ja, laten we, kijk, wij gaan een glossy maken. Het telt 63 pagina's. Dat hebben we niet voor niets voor 63 pagina's gekozen, maar 63 pagina's, omdat natuurlijk de profeet ook 63 jaar heeft geleefd.
We make a glossy which is 63 pages thick because the prophet lived for 63 years.
Een van de onderwerpen die we gaan behandelen is natuurlijk, je kunt er niet omheen, ja, is seks in de islam.
So one of the things we're going to discuss is sex. I mean, there's no way around
it. Wij zijn ook maar mensen en wij hebben dat ook gewoon nodig en wij voeren het ook uit. Dus ja, je moet wel erover praten, denk ik dan.
So is there sex in the Islam? We need to talk about that.
Dus je krijgt nu een artikel in de Mohammed Glossy. Verder zeg ik echt niks erover. Ik wil dat je mij precies wel aan de andere kant op gaat. Maar ik moet ook niet te veel erover vertellen, anders worden mijn redacteuren boos. En mijn eindredacteur al helemaal. Maar je moet natuurlijk wel heel goed kijken van wat gaan we behandelen en wat kunnen we niet behandelen. Zo'n heel simpel gekke voorbeeld, hier kan ik ook niks aan doen. Een van de vragen die ons heeft bereikt, mag je vrouw in de islam beffen, ja of nee? Ja, dat moet ik beantwoorden. Ik kan daar ook niks aan doen.
Oké, Yuri, the floor is yours. Give it away, man.
One of the questions which we need to address is whether you can have oral sex or not. We are only human and we have sex.
Oké, okay,
gezegd weer als?
So... These are the questions he's dealing with. So do you say yes or no? Is it going in, getting into the glossy? Yes or no?
Wat bedoel je? Of
this question.
Mag worden?
This question.
Het artikel gaat komen.
Yeah.
Het komt in het artikel.
It will be in the article. Okay, yeah, so these are the choices you have to make. Hans Nijhuis, he is the chief and editor of NRC Next. It's a morning newspaper. You were the only newspaper that printed a Charlie Hebdo cartoon on your front page. Are there limits to the freedom of expression for you and your newspaper?
Well, I can tell you that at NRC Next we work completely different from the glossy Mohammed.
No sex stories?
What we actually did for Mr. Westergaard, you had this Charlie Hebdo attack, terrible of course, just to give an impression of how it works at the newspaper. And we only thought, what's the best way to tell the story? And the best way, what was the story? There was an attack on a magazine. Many people did not know the magazine. It was actually not only on the magazine, but also on freedom of speech, which is something different than an attack on journalists. And it was an attack on the way we live, actually. So how can we express that in one, in a very quick way? So we thought we take the cover of Charlie Hebdo, we make our cover the cover of Charlie Hebdo, and we put three bullets through the cover and through the whole newspaper. So you saw it's Charlie Hebdo, then you see three bullets, that's ugly, and then you turn around and then you see again three bullet holes, even through the television lists and the puzzle. That was the, and afterwards people said on Twitter, oh, that was very brave. It was not meant to be brave. It was just meant to be a good act of journalism. And the reactions we got from our readers was, how do you dare to put bullet holes through my puzzle? So we said, well, how do you feel? He said, I feel personally attacked, you know, you attack, I'm out of my, I said, you are out of, I'm phoned these people, and I said, so you're out of your comfort zone. Yeah, I'm out of my comfort zone. Your ordinary way of life is disturbed. Yes, it's completely disturbed. And I think you get the message. And that was, so it was not bravery at all. It was, how do you express this? Did we think that night about somebody who would call us or do things or... Not really, yeah, about readers. And that's actually what I would like to say here. Do your job as good as you can do it, and that's it. And like the Americans say, publish and be damned, and we weren't damned at all. A strange thing that happened was that afterwards people saw this cover as a kind of statement, and some people put the cover in the classroom at school or behind their window, and actually there was a school, not in Amsterdam, not in the city of Mr. Van der Laan, but somewhere else, where they removed the poster, punished the teacher, and wrote a letter of excuse to the parents. And then we thought, that's very strange, because it was with this newspaper you could talk about this subject, and that's what you do at schools. And even at somebody with this poster behind his window, sorry, pardon my English, people throw stones at this person, and the police said, then maybe you should take away the poster. Well, this is Amsterdam, and in Amsterdam, I'm not from Amsterdam, I'm from The Hague, but it's the same there. This is Amsterdam, and we live here as ordinary people, and everybody's welcome, but these are the rules. And what of course, we had some phone calls from people, and what our major did, he assembled the media, and he said, the best thing that you can do is continue what you are doing. And that's what we should do. If you are a journalist, if you are a policeman, if you are a major, or if you are a debate center and you organize a debate, and the guy who you have invited happens to be, maybe a difficult subject because of the Charlie Hebdo things, if you have decided to have this evening, have this bloody evening. And now we are sitting here, and that's the way it should be, I think.
But for your newspaper, when you have to make choices, and you just argumented your choice when you wanted to place the Charlie Hebdo cartoon on your front page, are there no limits for you? Is there never a moment when you think, for example, let's take an example, yeah, the cartoon of Mr. Westergaard in September, it's 10 years ago since you made the drawing, would you print it on your front page?
Does it have to be, well... We don't think about somebody who will be insulted by it. We think, is this the best way to get the message to the readers?
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, the cartoon should be somewhere, because if you want to judge it, if you want to form your own opinion, that's what readers should do. You have to have this cartoon somewhere. Are there rules? Well, I'm from NRC, and at NRC we have a style book like this with all kind of rules about journalism, but they apply to decent journalism. And we have never, never any terrorist or Muslim or whatever has threatened us. Law firms have threatened us. Companies have threatened us. Lots of times. But then we continue what we are doing. And as long as it's decent journalism, it's allowed.
So, thank you.
There are rules, but they are applied to...
My question, would you...
Why should I give my... We did the Charlie Hebdo on the front page, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. But let me just picture the moment. It's a news moment. It's 10 years ago, since the cartoons. You might be in with all your colleagues thinking, what do we do with this day? If you would think, actually, I want to put it on the front page.
Yeah, if I would
cartoon,
think it's the best way to inform the readers, of course it will be on the front page. Yes, it will be on the front page, yeah. If that's the best way to inform the readers.
You're frowning?
Nou ja, ik zou dat niet doen, maar ik heb wel een goede reden ervoor, omdat wij natuurlijk ook heel anders werken dan de NRC Next. En gelukkig maar, daarvoor heb je ook de Moslimkrant. Ik vind niet dat je het recht hebt om mensen te kwetsen en te beledigen. En ik vind al helemaal niet dat je het recht hebt of moet hebben als journalist om mensen te gaan beledigen en te kwetsen.
We would not do that. We would not put it on the front page. We would have a different approach, because I do not believe you have the right to insult people. And it's especially not what journalism is for.
Zoals ik het hooggelijk kan begrijpen. Kijk, we hebben een discussie nu ook binnen de Moslimkrant. Iemand zegt, ja, moeten wij ook niet bijvoorbeeld de cartoon van En we zitten in Amsterdam, ik kom zelf uit Rotterdam. Mm-hmm. Moeten wij niet de cartoon van Anne Frank met Hitler in bed in de Moslimkrant gaan doen?
Shouldn't we put the cartoon of Anne Frank having sex with Hitler, or at least laying in the same bed with Hitler printing? Shouldn't we that be publishing?
Oral sex.
Yes. En als hoofdredacteur vind ik dat wij dat niet moeten doen.
En yeah. Chief editor zei, no, we shouldn't do
en
that.
En ik heb daar ook goede reden ervoor, omdat yeah. ik als geen ander als moslim heel goed kan begrijpen en heel goed de gevoelens van de Joodse gemeenschap in Nederland, maar ook uit respect voor Anne Frank,
say that
dat niet moeten
because
doen.
I understand the feelings of the Jewish community here because I'm a Muslim.
Dus wij zullen de tekening van cartoon van meneer Westgaard met alle respect voor hem, van hij moet kunnen tekenen wat hij wil, maar ik vind dat wij de vrijheid moeten hebben als moslim krant om ook te zeggen, wij gaan dat niet plaatsen.
So I believe I will not publish it. I have that freedom not to publish it.
You see it as an insult instead of something as an outing of freedom of speech. Shirin Moussa, you're the founder of Femme for Freedom, and you're also dealing with freedom of speech. When you hear this, where is for you your limit? Where are the limits for freedom of speech for you?
Ik wilde heel graag in het Nederlands reageren.
I wanted to react in Dutch if I can.
Yeah. Ik heb het ook van tevoren aangegeven, omdat ik ook altijd naar de juiste woorden moet zoeken.
Because searching for the exact right words is difficult.
En in het Nederlands heb ik wel eens moeite om naar de juiste woorden te zoeken om mensen niet te kwetsen. Of grimmige omstandigheden te creëren voor
mezelf. It's very important to search for the right words, not to insult people or hurt their feelings.
Maar ook om geen grimmige omstandigheden voor mezelf te creëren.
And also not to create dangerous circumstances for myself. So not to put myself in danger. So you have to choose your words carefully.
Why is it?
Ik heb te maken met vrouwen, vaak zijn het religieuze vrouwen of ook religieuze autoriteiten.
I have to work with women, often religious women or religious authorities.
En dan is het belangrijk om die binding te houden met die vrouwen. En ook de samenwerking met religieuze gezagsdragers goed te houden.
It's important to keep lines open with religious authorities in order to cooperate with them. So choose your words. So I have to choose my words always very carefully.
En zelf heb ik niet te maken gehad met personvrijheid, hè, maar wel dat ik, dat is iets van de afgelopen paar maanden geweest, dat ik in de media gezegd heb dat ik voor het recht om te zoenen ben en het recht om verliefd te worden. Ik zet me in voor vrouwen die gedwongen worden om te trouwen en om getrouwd te blijven.
So I have said things in the media in the last months that you have the right to kiss or the right to fall in love because I resist, I work for women who have been forced into marriage.
Ja, en dat een innige relatie of intimiteit alleen binnen het huwelijk kan. Als het niet binnen het huwelijk gebeurt, dan kan er eer gerelateerd geweld plaatsvinden of alle andere nare dingen. Ik vind het goed.
And the terrible thing is that if love is or intimacy is practiced outside marriage, a lot of terrible things can happen.
Shirin, I just want to ask you because of the time. Because what do you think when you, in your position, you're dealing with freedom of speech issues every day, as you are just explaining? Do you think everything should be printed? Or are there limits to
this? Zeker. Alles moet geprint kunnen worden.
Yes, sure. Everything should be put in print.
En alles moet ook gezegd kunnen worden.
And everything should be said, or you should be able to say everything.
Ik wil toch teruggaan naar de voorbeelden die ik heb gegeven.
Just to go back to some of my examples.
Omdat de dingen die ik heb gezegd geleid heeft. Het heeft hele nare omstandigheden of grimmige omstandigheden gecreëerd. Ik ben met alle reacties, zoals we moeten ons op Shirin Moussa gaan richten. We weten waar haar ouders wonen. Foto's die van mij, van Facebook, of niet van Facebook, maar de printscreens die op Facebook geplaatst zijn. Dat zijn Facebookprints van optredens in de media. Sorry. Uitlatingen die ik over vrouwenrechten en de seksuele vrijheid van vrouwen in de media heb gedaan.
Even though I choose my words very carefully, even though I choose my words very carefully, the things I said about love and marriage and women rights, I've been put in danger and met very horrible circumstances.
So your position is under pressure when we speak of freedom of speech. I want to go to close our discussion, and I want to close it with how do we need to deal with this situation in your point of view. Maar very shortly, what is your opinion about how we should deal with this?
Kijk, ik ben geen icoon zoals de heer Westergaard. Ik ben geen icoon
I'm
zoals Malala.
Like Mr. Westergaard.
Maar ik ben wel een burger. Ook mijn fundamentele rechten worden geschonden.
But I'm a citizen and my fundamental rights are being denied to me.
Of de fundamentele rechten van een bijstandsmoeder die ook op dit moment bedreigd wordt.
Or the fundamental rights of a young mother who is being threatened.
In een van onze grote steden, omdat zij gezegd heeft: ik ben voor vrouwenrechten en we moeten stoppen met geweld tegen vrouwen.
Okay, so there is no freedom of speech there.
Nee. Niet voor de gewone burger.
That's very clear. That's very clear. It's also very obvious that it makes you angry. But now my next question is: how do you think we should deal with this?
Dialogue with those people who tell these things, who write these things on social media. And these are not the people with you know, turbans or with beards. These are the doctors, the managers in our community.
Not the people from who you would expect.
No,
this.
And I also went to the police that please help me. Please help me. These are the print screens. These are the threats against me. And this is the situation of the woman who is getting these threats. She doesn't allow her children to go and play in the streets anymore.
So your point is the police should take this seriously and we should get into a dialogue.
Yes.
Okay. Brian Borzik, what do you think is a way to deal with this situation we're in?
Ja, het is heel ingewikkeld. Om twee redenen. Omdat de samenleving, zeker in Nederland, alleen maar aan het verharden is. Die klimaat is aan het verharden door natuurlijk ook de journalisten aan de ene kant. Dat is één. En aan de andere kant ook een andere groep mensen, een klein groepje weliswaar mensen, die ook de boel gewoon eigenlijk als het ware gewoon gijzelen. We gijzelen elkaar. De media aan de ene kant en die kleine groepje aan de ene kant die elkaar gijzelt. En wat je eigenlijk zou moeten doen is misschien op een gegeven moment toch zeggen, en ik denk ook dat politici, maar ook de heer Van der Laan en zijn collega's in de grote steden hebben daar zeker een rol in te spelen. Die moeten echt die ook eens een keer zeggen, de boel bij elkaar houden is veel moeilijker dan de boel uit elkaar gooien, vind ik persoonlijk.
En maar de opdracht voor Van der Laan heel concreet zou moeten zijn?
Ik kan geen opdracht geven aan een burgemeester als in Van der Laan. Ik ken
misschien
mijn plek in deze. Maar ik zou het wel fijn vinden als de heer Van der Laan ook gewoon met een aantal collega's van hem zegt voor jongens, zoals hij ook natuurlijk heel goed naar de media is gegaan toen dat is gebeurd wat in Parijs gaan, dat hij ook gewoon bij de moslims ziet geval of de andere mensen ook in de samenleving kunnen zeggen van laten we een keertje ook gewoon met elkaar een goede dialoog aangaan. Laten we elkaar ook pijn doen, maar niet elkaar kwetsen of beledigen. Pijn mag wel. Kwetsen en beledigen is een ander verhaal.
We are short in time. We have just 1 minute left, actually.
Okay,
so
1 minute.
Can you conclude, Hans Nijenhuis?
In 1 minute. There's a right to insult if necessary. There's no obligation to insult. So you always have to be clear, is it right, is it necessary or not? Then there's a question of taste. The Anne Frank cartoon, I didn't see it, but for me it's bad taste. Some of the Charlie Hebdo cartoons are really bad taste. So we picked one which we thought was very nice, where it was the message, love is stronger than hate. I'm all in favor of dialogue, but this is the Netherlands and it should be the Netherlands. It's a part of Western civilization. You're welcome, but this is the way we do the things.
Ja, maar dat is onzin, maar dan zou je dus nu zeggen dat de Arabische wereld dus geen discussie in dat er ook niet gebeurt. Dat gebeurt veel meer dan hier.
Can I ask you a question? You know, during the World Cup.
Shireen Moussa, I'm so sorry, but we're out of time. I really, as is.
Why?
One thing. Okay. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Okay. Shireen,
ga maar door.
I have a question. A few years ago we had the World Cup in Rio de Janeiro, and my Muslim friends Het was echt elke dag weer een andere fotootje van de profeet Jezus. He, de ene keer in een gele kleurshirt en dan weer in een andere emotie als het Nederlands elftal won of verloor. Dat deden mijn moslimvrienden. Ja, ik kan het beste uitdrukken. Dat deden mijn moslimvrienden. En met mijn moslimvrienden ging ik op Facebook in gesprek. Van waarom kunnen we wel, plaatsen jullie foto's van de profeet Jezus in verschillende emoties, shirtjes. En is een cartoon van de Deense cartoonist not done.
Okay, very short translation and then one reaction and then we conclude with Mr. Westergaard.
I asked my Muslim friends, why can you post all sort of posts on Jesus and is the simple cartoon by Mr. Westergaard not allowed?
En toen brak de hel los op Facebook.
En dan op Facebook het exploded.
Ik vertel jammer, ik vind de hemel veel mooier dan de hel. Maar even dat terzijde. Dat betekent dat die jongens ook helemaal niks van begrijpen. Want als ze heel goed de Koran zouden lezen. En Surat al-Baqarah, de koe. Daar staat erin dus dat wij alle profeten moeten respecteren. Van Mozes tot met Mohammed. Dus ik zou zeggen, de moslims juist. Ga een keertje ook trammeland maken om Jezus. Niet alleen maar om Mohammed iedere keer. Want ook Jezus is een profeet. Dus als zij dat willen doen, ik kan dat niet tegenhouden. Ik vind het alleen maar jammer. Het is alleen maar bewijzen dat ze echt nog steeds niet de kennis hebben om te begrijpen waar het echt om draait.
Joey, I think there is a lot of stuff to talk about for a next big discussion here in the Bali. I want to conclude with Mr. Westergaard. I'm sorry for the public that we cannot continue, but there's always way to discuss at the bar, of course. Mr. Westergaard, I want to ask you your message to young cartoonists, journalists, people working in the media. Would you say think twice when you make a cartoon that might provoke fanatics, or do you say go on with it, damn the consequences?
Yes, I would prefer the last version. Because according to the way we have treated our new fellow citizens of Muslim origin, I think we are on a kind of, we have a moral right to live our life just as we have done before. We have welcomed these people and they stay with us now and we cannot change our traditions. Yeah.
Thank you.
We promised that there would be the possibility to ask Mr. Westergaard a question, one or two. So we are way over time. But if there's anybody who feels the urge to say something to Mr. Westergaard or ask him something, then I will try to come to you. And yeah, you can also shout, but people there want to hear you as well.
Mr. Westergaard, just wondering, some of the of a few newspapers in the Netherlands has chosen not to publish the Charlie Hebdo cartoon. So, just wondering, what would your advice be for these newspapers?
Are we talking about newspapers in Denmark, for example?
The Dutch, some of the Dutch newspapers.
Yeah. I think I must start in Denmark. We are approaching now the 10th anniversary for the publishing of these so-called Muhammad cartoons. And we, the cartoonists, well, I am in a way retired, but we are very excited to see how would they celebrate this situation. Would they show, reprint the cartoons or not?
And what is
there's a lot of fear in the Danish newspaper world nowadays, physical fear. So, and you can see newspaper buildings in Denmark, they are just today like fortresses with iron bars and everything to protect. So I have a suggestion, and it would be that you print the whole newspaper. I think it's the 5th of September in black. So, yes, that's my suggestion, but I'm not an editor-in-chief, so it has no...
Jury, waar ben je? Hier zijn nog vragen. En dan kan Hans Nijenhuis en... The glossy, will it be in black?
You're 80 years old, and you said you can handle the situation because you're 80 years old. But what would you advise a young artist, say, an artist of 35 years old who get death threats every day?
Well, I really don't know the answer. I think that society owes him, as what happened in my situation, to get protection. And that is a very great thing about our societies, that we get this protection. And but I will understand everybody's fear, and I understand that they are scared. And my situation would have been complete otherwise if I had been only 35 years, something like that. It's a difficult question. But I don't think you can keep creative people down. That's not possible.
One more question. Last question.
Before the drawing of Muhammad, were you afraid before?
No, not so much. But the situation turned completely. As my house was attacked and there was an attempt to kill me, I understood that the situation had been quite otherwise. Before that, we had in a period of half a year, we had lived in the so-called safe houses, when you live in remote places in a little house. And that was a very depressing experience. But now we live in a house which I don't think you should try to attack. You should just press the doorbell.
Thank you, Mr. Kurt Westergaard, for your arrival here at the Bali. Applause, please. Thank you, Hans Nijhuis. There's a present for you, Mr. Westergaard.
Ik geef mijn microfoon het goed. Heel kort. Misschien om echt te laten zien dus dat wij uit de grond van onze hart, als moslims in ieder geval hem ook echt alle ruimte bieden. En dat hij voor ons altijd mag tekenen wat hij wil. Wil ik hem dit bieden, misschien dat hij hem kan openen. It's for you.
It's for you.
Yeah, it's for you.
Dank je wel. Oké. Thank you. I'm very happy to receive this.
Yeah.
And I have been very happy to meet you.
Well, it's for me also a pleasure to meet you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah. We willen het laten zien.
Yeah.
Wij dachten misschien heel leuk, de moslimkrant, het is allemaal vergeven, dames en heren.
We kunnen gewoon lekker.
Tutti pardoni.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Westergaard. Okay.
I think I can put it in my bag.
Yes, I'll get your bag and your hat. Okay, I don't know what time it is. It's probably way too late. We really need to go. But after the break, there's a talk show, satirical talk show, and Hans Steeuwe, of course. And music. Yeah?